All right, shall we kick it off?
Yeah, let's kick it off.
Okay, welcome.
Welcome, everybody. I'm Heather Cameron Bevan with AtlasRTX. I am Client Success Director for Higher Education.
And I'm Chris Austin. I'm the Director of Market Development here at AtlasRTX.
And today we're going to talk about real-time chatbots for student recruiting, specifically as it relates to a new product we are launching called EduBot.
Great. So just so you know, we're going to be taking questions at the... There we go. We're starting off on a good foot here. So we're going to be taking questions throughout the webinar. We'll be doing a live Q&A session at the end of the webinar. So feel free as you're listening to the presentation and anything that jumps out to you that you want to have a question answered on, please feel free to type it into the Q&A section of the webinar video. And we will get to those at the end of the webinar. So let's kick it off. So we just wanted to talk a little bit about the current state of communication today, especially with the generation that is coming into the college and university level, current high school students. Most of those are Generation Z. And over the last 20 years, we've really seen a huge seismic shift in how communication has changed with Generation Z. Generation Z members are really the true first digital natives. They have grown up in the digital age. They really have known nothing else. You can watch many YouTube videos of high school kids wondering how a rotary phone works. So they're born into the digital age. They're comfortable with smartphones from a very young age. I've got an 8-year-old right now who at 2 years old was already playing games on a smartphone. So they are very comfortable with technology. They have very fast attention spans. They are not willing to wait. They're used to Google giving them answers instantly, asking Siri and Alexa for answers to questions. There's no more waiting around for information. They also don't care about normal business hours. Today's youth, they're used to online shopping where the store is open 24 hours a day. They don't really understand or accept the fact that you are closed and you will get back to them tomorrow or the next day or within a certain period of time. They want their information right away. And they also prefer mobile and text communications over all other forms of communication. So they really don't like talking to someone on the phone even or in person. They prefer to text, they prefer to use social media and other social messaging apps. So we talked about attention spans. Just how fast are they these days? Well, 82% of consumers rate an immediate response as extremely important to them. They are not willing to wait around. They are impatient. They will move on to the next option if they can't get the information they want quickly. The average attention span now of an internet user is just 6 seconds. And when you compare that to the average 30-second television commercial, you have a very small window to get your information to grab that user, that consumer, and make them stay and learn more information about your product or service. Comparatively, a goldfish, and don't ask us how we got the scientific information. It was a lot of trial and error, but a goldfish, the average attention span is 9 seconds. So it's really amazing to see how attention spans have dropped over 50% since the year 2000 with today's internet users. So they are really looking for information quickly. They want it no matter what time of day it is, and they want it on whatever device they are currently using. So we speak to 24-hour service. People today are not willing to just operate within the 8-to-5 time frame. 65% of Generation Z prefer to communicate online versus in person. So they want to text, they want to type on a computer or on their phones. They don't like to do face-to-face communication, at least not right at the beginning. 75% of millennials in Generation Z would rather talk or rather text than talk. So that's even with technology and even not in a face-to-face manner. They would rather text someone than talk to them on the phone. 65% of internet users say the best feature of a chatbot is that 24-hour service. They can jump online at 2 o'clock in the morning, 4 o'clock in the morning, 11 o'clock at night, whatever it is, and there's a chatbot there ready to engage them. They really appreciate that. And now over 50% of customers expect a business to be open 24 hours a day. So no longer is it okay for you to have a contact form or even a live chat bubble on your website that is unavailable after hours. consumers want you to be available the same way at midnight as you are at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. So things have changed.
All right. With this, we see a big opportunity as part of the student journey. And this is where EduBot comes in. But we first want to talk about some student recruitment challenges that we are seeing that are coming into the foreground of 2020. The first one is talking about global competition. Research is suggesting that 30% of students are applying now for 7 or more schools. Lots of opportunities, lots of options. This is Gen Z, end of the millennial generation. They want to be able to look at options, weigh their options, and feel like that they made the most informed and appropriate decision for themselves. One of the things that we are seeing, and this has been happening prior to being with Atlas, I was in marketing for education, and enrollment is dropping. We're seeing a steadily decline. For the 8th year in a row, we do know that some of this is impacted by a very strong economy, but that isn't always the case, and that isn't the only reason that enrollment has dropped. 61% of Gen Z are actually still in high school, and a fair percentage of that is actually in elementary and middle school at this point. So you are on the beginning of a cost of communication change. Once we get all of these Gen Zs into adulthood, we're going to see a lot more communication in the way of messaging, chatbots, all of that. One of the other big challenges we are seeing and hearing from our university institutional partners is admission staffs feeling overworked and underpaid. This also kind of ties into the financial aid departments, where in one such research study, respondents indicated that 85% of them would consider leaving the higher education sector altogether. A lot of that has to do with answering the same questions over and over, just the volume of work and not having enough time. There's just this kind of sense of being time impoverished and being able to get it all done. The other one is lack of financial support for students. For many of the students, financial commitment of a university is not affordable. It doesn't feel affordable. You're looking for many different options from grants and scholarships. And we can see that this is something that is a challenge because we are seeing university institutional websites. They're really making the financial aid and the scholarship and the state funding and all the areas a lot more robust on their websites to try and answer that cost question. Generation Z, they have seen their parents potentially go into the financial aid crisis where they paid a lot of money for education, weren't able to find the jobs quickly, and a lot of student debt was attributed as a result. The other piece to their available resources, wouldn't it be great to have a system in place that actually can help your attrition rate within your own staffing? So let's talk about admission office challenges. We're just gonna focus on that for a minute. In a recent RFP, it was noted for a 33,000 enrollment university that their admissions department annually collects 37,000 calls. So that means they either have to make a call out or they've requested calls in or they need to get back to somebody because they had an inquiry. So roughly we're looking 3,000 a month. When you get into financial aid, we're looking at a third of that volume actually happens in August and September. So a lot of call volume. Now, the interesting thing about this, it's all on the phone. And we've just told you that Generation Z would rather text versus talk to a human in the initial stages of their student journey. If we took this and put it into more call center terms and said, and we attributed 5 minutes to the length of each phone conversation, We feel this is probably low. It's probably more like 10 minutes a call. What would that equate to a number of hours in a year? When we're looking at 3,000 hours, one admission staff person has to spend on the phone annually, dedicated to just phone calls. Now, this doesn't take into account emails and the number of times you're trying to contact somebody, and in today's age, possibly even texting these individual students and or parents back. If we looked at that at a $40,000 a year annual salary, we're looking at about 1.5 FTEs just to man the phones, okay? This doesn't take into account all the other things that they have to do. And we venture to say that probably 50% or more of what they're fielding in phone calls and or answering are typically asked questions that a chatbot could easily answer and take that workload off of an employee and reduce that whole burnout factor. All right. So one other piece of this that's really important is time of day engagement. We track time of day engagement, and we've seen it with all of our custom chatbots that we are doing in other industries, is we are seeing about two-thirds of our activity is happening outside of business hours. People are engaging with this chatbot, not necessarily 8 a.m. to 5 p.m., but they're actually engaging on the weekdays and the weekends, and we're trying to hear, this is showing when admissions office, typical admissions office hours are, 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. And with this, you don't need, you could use an EduBot instead, have a chatbot answering outside when Gen Z want to talk to you and have those questions. The chatbot doesn't have a bad day, the chatbot's never sick, the chatbot can get back to and answer those questions in real time. So we wanted just to show you some typical office hours. We're not trying to pick on any universities or institutions here, but just to merely just kind of prove the point that this idea of business hours is truly, it is something. We have an 8 to 5, and in several cases we have, you know, we have holidays. A chatbot is there for holidays. A chatbot is during Christmas break, summer break, and anytime that there isn't a person. Now let's look at financial aid office hours. In this case, financial aid can typically have some different types of office hours. Sometimes they'll close for certain days. And we really want the student to have a good experience. We know in the last 5 years, there's been this big lift and push to improve the student experience. They are consumers of our college. It's more like a business, and they are consumers and have expectations. One of the things we like about this, if you look in the right-hand upper corner, is we are talking about, they're trying to make a better student by saying, we are committed to responding to you within 1 to 2 business days. It might actually be 2 to 3. This lets you know that they actually are very, very busy. And this is a contact us business hour. This is actually during the busy season. This is all the time. So they're trying to make a better student experience and give that expectation. But as we talked about, Gen Zs have moved on. And we don't want this to be a reason we've lost out on a prospective student. So let's talk about the prospective student journey. Where EduBot is going to focus is really in this kind of research and consideration phase of their journey. What are the things they're going to ask the most? What are they researching the most? And what puts you into their consideration set to actually fill out an application or start the application process? So what are they researching? One of the things with our experience and with our current chatbots is, whether it's a graduate or undergrad, we're seeing that cost really is one of the top priorities. It may not be very much in the beginning of that prospective student's journey. They might not necessarily think about the cost, because every student's situation is different. Their parents may be helping them pay. They may have to look for financial aid or scholarships or something like that. But cost always comes down to it. And we know that at the end of the day, they could have 10 institutions that they're looking at, and they're going to look at the costs, and their parents are going to start weighing in there. So it's whether I get a certificate program, I go to community college, I go to a four-year university, I go to for-profit versus private, I go in-state, out-of-state, all of these different options that they're going to be weighing. Secondly is time. How much time is it going to take me? Some of this is, how long will it take me to get my degree? Can I take online concurrently with brick and mortar? Can I take classes in the summer? Are there shortened classes that aren't necessarily full semester? How long will it take me if I have to work? There's all these things they're looking at from a time factor. And not just how long will it take to complete the degree, but can I take classes and work, or can I fit this into my schedule? The next one is the requirements. We do know a lot of coming straight out of high school, students are working with their advisors at their high schools. But we, as we know, there is a big strain on the education system and funding in general. And so they're time impoverished. They may not be doing the due diligence that they're required to at their high school just because their caseload is too high. So these questions are going to come up whether you are 17, 18, or 25, or 40. How do I apply? What kind of test scores? Where do I get my transcripts? What do you need? And all of these are very, very typical and repeatable types of questions. There might be some differences in deadlines. There might be some differences in what test scores, what they have to be, what the thresholds are. But for the majority of the requirements, there are a lot of Q&A questions that are very, very similar. And finally, what's the opportunities? We are seeing just with the financial aid crisis with and all of that happening, you are seeing where a lot of universities and institutions now have pages completely devoted, and all of their programs are devoted to talking about what kind of opportunities can I have? What kind of salary can I expect? Is there someone to help me? So these are other areas that are very, very important to prospective students. So let's take a journey and bring it back down a little bit from this high level into, and we're going to talk about a couple of personas of students that you may have at your institutions.
Sure. So it is sometimes often hard to take these big ideas and boil them really down to specific people. Your admissions team, your recruiting team is speaking to individuals. They're not speaking to a group. They're not speaking to an entire generation. So we want to make sure that our chatbot and your experience is providing, you know, a positive, engaging experience for each of these individuals, no matter who they are. So we decided to create two personas. We have Emily here. She's a senior in high school. She's located in Texas. She's a high school senior, like I said. She also works in the evenings on the weekends at a restaurant. And she really is involved in school. She's got a lot going on. And she's looking for schools. So first, she's looking for in-state schools to help out her parents a little bit. They will be footing the bill. So she's not entirely worried too much about the cost, but she is trying to be a little bit conscious about that. She does play sports, so she's looking for a good athletic and rec program at the school she will go to. And she's not quite sure what she wants to major in, so she's doing a lot of research. She knows she wants to work with children when she gets out of school. So she's doing a lot of research on what programs will get her down that path. Activity-wise, you know, again, she's a typical high school student, so she's spending all of her time on her phone. She does work after school and on the weekends. And by the time she gets home, she gets through all of her daily homework, her sport activities, possibly her work schedule. That's when she can really sit down and start doing her research. So she's doing her research late at night, on the weekends, in between her other activities. She may be sitting in the car looking at her phone as she's being driven to a sport event. So she's not operating within those daytime hours for the most part. And she's getting frustrated. She's finding that school websites that she visits are just full of information, overflowing. They're not easily navigated. She's trying to find the information she needs, and she's having difficulty doing that. And when she's having difficulty, there's no one to reach out because it's 11 o'clock at night or possibly midnight, or she's on a weekend, and there's no one at the school to talk to. Then on the other end, we have Michael. Michael didn't go to college straight out of high school. He actually enlisted in the military. So he's now 26. He's now thinking about going back to school. He has a family, so he needs to find a job that can support them. So he's actually doing a little bit of different research. He's not so interested in the social aspect of the school or the recreation. He's looking, how do I go back to school to finish my degree so I can support my family? He's being frustrated because he needs to be able to take classes online or possibly at night or on the weekends, you know, atypical hours. And he wants to be there for his daughter when she gets home from school and to be able to work during the day to support her while he's going to school. So he's looking for a different track. He's also concerned about how long it's gonna take and what the costs are. He's trying to support his family and work. He's paying for this all himself, so cost and time are big factors for him. And finally, because of his military status as a veteran, he does have a GI Bill. He's not really sure about the benefits. He's got some questions about that, how that's actually going to help him pay for school. So you have these two very different situations, two people that are both researching schools. They're looking for different information, but they are both doing it off hours. They're doing it outside of a normal day. They're doing it at night, on weekends, whenever they have time, and they're finding some difficulties. So when it really comes down to it, how do we help people like Emily and Michael get the information they need, feel comfortable about your university, and get them to apply?
So hence brings in the focus of our RTX programs. And RTX stands for real-time experience. And that's why it's in our name, because we are we develop real-time experience through our AI guided flow chatbots. So what we want to do is provide a guided, personalized conversation through the research phase of the journey. Guided in the sense of what is the natural flow that a prospective student is going to take as they're conversing with a chatbot. Can it seamlessly handle thousands of conversations in real time? Our AtlasRTX chatbots have the bandwidth to handle hundreds of simultaneous engagements. So think of your own personal institutional web page. You could have 500 plus pages that are live in there with just oodles of information. And think if you had the chatbot instance there 500 times, it could have a conversation every 30 seconds. So there is no issue with having simultaneous engagements, and it's live 24/7. Again, it doesn't have a bad day. We drive inquiries and initiate applications. That's the whole goal, through the guided conversation and or guided meeting buttons, or we can free type our questions. We provide real-time language translation. So that's one of the coolest things about the chatbot, is it can automatically translate. Just basically, I start typing in a native language, it will respond to it and change out the chatbot. We'll actually show an example of that later on in the presentation. But it can translate over 100 languages. So we're talking from Spanish to Farsi to Hebrew. So we are able to accommodate several languages. We do find in many, many cases, English is a second language or a native language that they're learning. So they do stay in that, but we do see quite a bit of Latino and Hispanic families whose parents are actually coming on. And that is an added benefit. If that parent wants to communicate with the chatbot, it is their kids typically don't have any issues because they're in classes, in especially in the US, but in out of country, we do have the language capability to be 100% in a different language. We can engage with prospective students and their parents basically on their schedule through their preferred method of communication with the chatbot. So 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, no holidays, no breaks. The chatbot never gets tired of answering the same question over and over. AI-powered chatbot, it matches your institution's brand. So what this looks like, the EduBot is a product. It's in the box product. So we do custom chatbots and we do product chatbots. And the idea with this is, it isn't going to be the same chatbot. So if you're institution A and I'm institution B, your chatbot isn't the same color. It doesn't have the same name. The responses aren't the same. There is a set of questions that are similar, but it's your voice in the answers. It's your links. It is your conversation. It's your logo, it's your colors, it could be even your mascot, it could be whatever mascot, it could be the bulldog bot or something like that. Anyway, so you have the ability to customize it to your institution's brand, so it feels personal and custom to your university or college. What does all this mean at the end of the day? It means that you can have a piece of technology without scaling staff or resources that will take some of that burden off your existing staff.
Real quick before we continue, for those of you that jumped on a little bit late, we will be doing a Q&A session at the end, so feel free at any point throughout the presentation to type in a question in the Q&A box and we'll answer those at the end of the presentation.
Thanks, Chris. All right. So here's where we get to the really, really cool stuff. We can get excited about this. We wanted to bring up a case study and for Purdue University. We are working with their Krannert School of Management. In this particular use case, we are doing graduate degree programs at the business college at the master's level. We are rolling out PhD and undergrad in the next 6 months to, PhD will actually be this month, and undergrad in the next 6 months. So we want to talk about the results that they're seeing with a custom chatbot and what some of EduBot is actually modeled after. So what were Purdue University's challenges? What were they seeing? And why did they seek out a chatbot? They wanted to engage Gen Z and the cuspers of the millennial audiences in a preferred interface. Their only interface of interaction was filling out a form. And so that was it. And they didn't have anything else. They wanted to respond to prospective students on a global scale. Currently, right now, they have roughly 40% of their chatbot activity is actually international. India, China, and Nigeria are some big area, main areas that we are seeing engagements come from. And they didn't have the staff to, they didn't want to expand the staff. They didn't have the budget to expand the staff. They wanted to open a channel of rich conversation that could be actually managed by a team of two or three. They wanted to keep users on their website longer, so that time on site. We know time on site is a very important metric, especially if you're redoing your sites and you're looking to keep users engaged with your website. Time on site is definitely a metric that is being tracked in the digital age. But we want that to be an enriching and informative experience for the student. So step in the chatbot. So some of the results that we saw through March through February of 2020, so literally now, that we're seeing overall, we want to just talk about, we had roughly, if we looked at all engagements over that time, 54% of those engagements were handled 100% by the chatbot. Either it was a back and forth, it answered questions, I typed my questions, it gave me what I needed, took me to the degree, or it gave me my cost. And it set me off and I was done. I didn't necessarily put my contact information in. I didn't need anything. I could click out to an application. So there's lots of actions that are a result of these engagements, but 100% of that. So over 50% of the conversations. And this number is actually rising as this chatbot gets smarter and smarter. Next, we're seeing that almost 57% of the engagement actually happen outside of business hours. And in Purdue's case, it's a little bit unique because of some time zone differences of that international student. We see really, really heavy activity with the chatbot from 8 to 10 a.m., which if we were to change up those business hours, you probably would see that two-thirds being outside. But just due to the international time zones, we do see an overlap in the business hours. But this bot is pretty much mostly autonomous. It does have human interaction, so it's a custom bot, which would be a little bit different from what EduBot will offer. And in this case, we're looking at overall, we're seeing an 8% increase in chatbot users who actually completed an application. Now, in my previous experience, we saw a 2-4% increase in applications completed from just our digital advertising campaigns. We were jumping for joy and we were super happy. And I'm sure most institutions would love to see an 8% increase just in completed applications. We know it's a numbers game. People aren't a number, but we know it's a numbers game. We have to get these number of applications so that we can get them to be admitted, we get them to enroll, we get them to matriculate and pay their
this is actually 8% of total engagements that completed an application. So this is an 8% conversion rate. So if you had 100 people that engaged with the chatbot, eight of those 100 went all the way to a completed application. So the increase is actually much, much higher. We'll
get to that. Right. We'll get to that in just a minute. So what we're seeing, what creators saw was, they weren't sure if how this was going to work, but they said, nobody's filling out our website form anymore. So they're still filling it out, but 51.2% more students are engaging with their chatbot than actually submitting their contact form. So as you can see on the right, it's a guided conversation. It's friendly. It's in a manner that they're used to. Where the left is a lot of boxes, a lot of check marks. I don't know what I want. I'm not ready, that kind of thing. With the guided flow, you can go in, you can do some exploration before actually filling out the form. So that was very, very positive results. Not something, and they're meaningful, and not something that actually the Craner School expected. So let's talk about the results. Right now, we're looking from March 2019 to November 2019, and this is all based on their cycles. So we're looking at year-over-year cycles. And what were the results that we are seeing as a result of the chatbot being executed onto their master's pages? So what they saw was a 21.5% growth in inquiries compared to prior year entry terms. So that means more people are inquiring about their master's degree programs than prior. So that site traffic, bot traffic, engagement traffic, they're gaining more names, more leads that they can actually nurture through the funnel and become prospective actual students versus prospective students. The other piece, they weren't necessarily leading, one of their top KPIs was not necessarily applications submitted. they wanted just to answer basic questions because they had a small team. But what we found was these inquiries actually did lead to application growth. So we had almost a 70% initiated application growth compared to previous cycles. That means they were directly attributed to the chatbot. So 70% went and initiated and started the application process. If we look even farther, 17% overall, they had an application growth where they actual completed applications compared to previous cycles, previous year, school year, were actually directly attributed to the chatbot. So I'm sure most institutions would love to see a 17% completed application growth just to see those enrollment numbers come up, even 1 to 2%. So the Purdue University Credit School of Management, we wanted to just kind of give you a quick demo of how their chatbot works. And just so you can see that we're going to engage prospective students in real time. So in this scenario, I'm just going to pause right here. We do a chat with us. In their case, it's a registered bot. And the reason we have a registered bot is we feel at this level, for this cost, price point, most individuals who are chatting with the chatbot are actually fairly serious. And what we have found is pretty much 99% of the contact information that is filled in is 100% accurate. So in an undergrad scenario, where we're looking at undergrad for the EduBot, it would be in an unregistered mode where they wouldn't have to put this in, but we may ask for their first name to build that rapport. So as you can see, we're going to put our own fake name in so that we know it's test data. And it's going to start chatting. And we're just going to let this play and we'll just talk through as it goes. So it's going to ask, this is the guided piece where you see the buttons. It's going to empower the guided as well as conversational. So guided would be, I'm going to click on an MBA program. I'm going to get the options that are available, main buckets, and then I can dive a little bit deeper in. I want to do the global MBA. I'm going to type it in. So that is the free form where I can just ask the questions that I want. We're going to provide details. We can answer all the other common questions, financial aid, admissions, requirements. As you can see, we put the top buttons that individuals have clicked on, and those have basically morphed over time. One of the things with the chatbots, like I said before, is we don't set it and forget it. This is constantly, we're constantly evaluating this chatbot's performance. How is it answering questions? Do we need to improve? Do we need to change the buttons? Do we need to add a button? Do we need to change what it's saying? All of those enhancements are happening all of the time. So you can link out to specific pages, as you can see here. That will be a feature of the EduBot. Here is an example of the 100 languages. So it's just, you can just start typing in your native language and it will just automatically switch.
So pretty cool.
Can I schedule an appointment? Yep. So you get a sense for that. So now let's talk about EduBot, our new product. EduBot is designed to be in the box, kind of in the box, but out of the box product in the sense of we want to develop most of our custom bots are, they start as a baby Yoda, so we're going to use a Star Wars reference, and then they turn into a Jedi, right? So that's the idea, and that's done over time, and traffic is really important, engagement that we get lots of conversations happening in order for the AI to happen, the tuning to take place, and for that chatbot to become very, very sophisticated. If we were to have several institutions on one bot, not the same bot, your bot's different, but all on the same platform, the exponential learning happens much, much quicker. So that baby Yoda becomes the advanced Jedi much, much quicker. So in an expedited time frame. And we've seen this with other verticals that we are in, like home builder. We have done this in home builder, and we can't believe what kind of outcome we have seen just in 30 and 90 days of having a systemized bot like this. Okay, so the focus, what is the EduBot focus and the key performance indicators? It's going to focus on programs, it's going to focus on admissions, and it's going to focus on cost. All of the areas that are around there, it's going to be very robust. There'll be a set of questions, a very robust set of questions, and then each institution has customizable answers, links, all of that is yours. With that though, we don't want to say that the student experience is going to be, this is the only thing it does. We're still cognizant of that student experience. There's going to be, where can parents go? Where can current students click on? Are we able to look at campus life? Are we able to look at meal plans, housing? All of that will be there. It just won't be, we won't basically have, maybe we won't have as many conversation pieces to it, but we will have answers and we will have places to direct the chatter to on your sites. So with this in mind, the number one goal of the EduBot is the number of questions it can actually answer. So the idea is this is an autonomous bot. You don't need a lot of human interaction with it. And so how many questions in 1 week, 1 month, 1 year can this bot answer for you that so your staff can work on the things that are most important, which is getting those getting students matriculated. Second, prospective students. We want to visit inquiries and lead capture. It could be, would you like to schedule a visit? And that's one of our call to actions. Would you like to learn more? All of these are ways that you can capture leads, set up a visit, or do other things where you can put this lead into some sort of lead nurturing campaign. And finally, the ultimate call to action, which would be drive online applications. We know with our experience and case study with Purdue that applications is obviously an outcome. It's correlation, it's directionally correlated to having this positive experience and being able to get questions answered. So along with this, you also get your professional services team that comes with AtlasRTX. So you get a person like me who dives into the analytics on a weekly basis as we start, and then over time it will be, you know, every other week, and then we go to monthly, and then we're constantly looking for how do we enhance the conversation? How do we make it the best customer experience and or student experience for you, in this case, possible? So things like chatbot coverage, what are we looking at? What's our outside of business hours versus inside of business hours? Which days of the week are we the most heaviest with our chatters? Are we seeing more chats happen as a result of a particular digital campaign that we sent out or an email campaign that we sent out? And we like to know what your digital campaign schedule is, because then we have a sense of, okay, we saw high chat times here. Look what happened as a result of the efforts that your marketing team is doing to bring prospective students to the site. The other piece is kind of looking at a tree map of chatbot topics. And this is where we figure out what this flow looks like. Are they going to apply? Which apply is the top one in this particular use case? Work experience, they're looking at tuition, they're looking at the GRE, MBA. So we're able to identify which are the most talked about topics, and we're able to enhance and modify these chatbots to be even more efficient over time. The other piece that's really valuable in the analytics, and you see this as a timestamp, is to track the buttons and topics over time to see, oh, what's most important right now? Okay, so I'm seeing apply is the most important thing. It comes up and down, tuition and other specialized masters. In this case, you're seeing over time. This can actually effectively, you can do messaging on your site. It's very, you can see what your patterns are for your chatters, and then you can change out some of the messaging on your site and or your digital campaigns if there's something that you are looking to do to change out that message. Maybe you have a hard-hitting message, a lot stronger call to action on around cost or on timing or things like that. And one of the things you saw the requirements jump up and you saw the specialized masters come down. That was we had a chatbot change. We enhanced this chatbot where we started diving into the conversations, and we got super granular now with the MBA programs, and we created more buttons and buckets based on what their chatters were typing in. Requirements are really, really high in December because they have a very, very big end of year deadline.
And what's really cool about this is imagine being able to take this data from just your chatbot and help your entire digital marketing team, from your website developers to your social media managers, and focus on certain topics throughout the year at different times. So like Heather said, in September, requirements leaped straight to the top of the list. How cool would it be to be able to update your website right on the homepage, all of your social media, to focus on requirements at that time so that those students coming to your site looking for information, many of them will be focused on requirements, give them that information and that access to that information as easily as possible.
Great. So with that, we know that that's a very, very quick overview, but that is gives you a sense of what our EduBot product will look like.
Great, so we're gonna dive into questions now. So feel free to post any questions. We've got a few that have come in already, but if you have any questions of your own, go ahead and type them in the Q&A section right now. The first question that I have is that you talk about live agents in the chatbot for Purdue, but this bot will not have a live chat agent, correct? Is that correct?
Correct, this chatbot is designed to be autonomous and it will actually send an email notification with a link to the conversation, so that you know what kind of action would be required, whether it's a visit or application, you'd be notified that they went to the application page and you could track that name into the application, into your student information system or your CRM. The other thing that Purdue did is, because they are a small team, they actually use student ambassadors. So they have MBA student ambassadors responding to prospective students within their the email and message string of the chatbot. And we all know with Gen Z and millennial, that whole influencer piece, I want to know from a current student, how do they like the program? And we know that that is very, very important tool for them to recruit new students into their programs.
Got it. Second question is, would the chatbot have any sort of integration such as Salesforce?
So we do have the ability to integrate into any sort of CRM or student information system, the SIS, with Salesforce. No two integrations are alike, but we do integrations with that. In this case, EduBot would not be an integratable product, but we do custom chatbots for education that would be integratable, in the sense of it would capture that contact information, it would go into your CRM, and you could actually then from there do lead nurturing or whatever other things that you could do within the marketing function.
Gotcha. So talk about real quick, just the process. You know, we're driving leads, we're driving inquiries, we're driving applications. Obviously the applications would probably happen directly on their website, mm-hmm. Through their existing systems. In terms of leads and inquiries, how does that look with EduBot?
With EduBot, it's an email. So we're doing an email that is coming across. So there'll be an email alert you would receive, and you would designate what email address that goes to. And in there will be their contact information, a link to the conversation, where you can either schedule that visit, respond to them. We do have this text out capability. There is some text out capabilities with our current chatbots that you could actually add on as an additional feature with your EduBot.
Great. This question might have come in right as you were actually answering it live, but for those who may have missed it, you mentioned that the bot would match the brand of our school. What exactly does that look like?
So currently, as you saw it in Purdue's case, you know, you're seeing the brown colors and you're seeing the logo and the chatbot. We could have all of that is customizable to your colors of your school. It can have a call out that's yours. You can name the chatbot anything that you want. Like it could be even your mascot name. So you have the ability to customize that. It could even be, you can have a custom icon that's inside the chatbot window. So all of that is customizable. Your answers are customizable, your links, your costs, your deadlines, all of that is your school's. The main thing, the structure of the guided conversation and the questions that will be asked are fairly, would be similar across different institutions.
Gotcha. let's see. Do we get to choose the questions and the answers that the bot will address?
There are, we will have a customizable area that is, so some of the buttons are dynamic. So if you don't have certain programs or certain categories or don't want them, you don't actually have to display those from the guided standpoint. The other piece of it is we have set up a section that is why your university, what is your unique selling proposition? Mm-hmm. What makes you different? So we will have an area there that is very much, that'll be 100% customizable for each university or institution, where the other ones for admissions and financial aid and kind of diving into the different programs, those would be a little bit more formatted.
Gotcha. And you mentioned with Purdue's where they capture the contact information at the beginning of the chatbot. We saw the demo there. So in EduBot's case, at what point is contact information captured so that the university can then reach out to that student?
Okay. So we're looking to put a little lower if we were to think of a marketing funnel, right? We're looking to bring that when they get deeper into the conversation. So they've gone into more of the admissions and they're asking, they're going in deeper into admissions. At that point, we may ask if they'd like to schedule a visit, or if with financial aid, would they like to schedule a visit or make an appointment with a financial aid advisor. So we're going a little bit deeper into the conversation. It isn't going to be up front. The apply will be there all the time. We want that strong CTA to always kind of be pretty much top of mind. But we're gonna capture that in the deeper in the funnel. And we monitor this over time. If we're finding that it's too early, we'll move it a little bit later. Maybe it's a little too late and we'll move it a little bit earlier. And we know that that can be different for depending on time of year, that kind of thing. But we're going to monitor that over time. We have a good feel for where it goes and where it should be. We definitely want to make sure that we test and monitor over time. And that's part of the chatbot enhancement. Okay. That's continual.
And speaking of enhancement, someone asked, do they have to pay for the improvements to the bot, or are those included?
No, all enhancements. So all professional services, meaning you have a client success manager that would be that you would work with on a daily and weekly, monthly basis. All of the reporting is included, and all enhancements with EduBot. Anything that we do for one, we would do for anyone who's using the EduBot product.
Okay. I think that's all the questions we have.
Okay. All right.
We'll wrap it up. We're in Park City. We've got a day to Deer Valley shortly this afternoon. So so we will let you get back to your day. Thank you for attending. Thank you for joining us. Thank you for learning about EduBot and the amazing ways that we're helping schools like Purdue really make their outreach and recruiting efforts more efficient, more effective.
And if you'd like an EduBot demo.
Yep, we're doing demos, as you see on the screen there. Check out our webpage, atlasrtx.com/EduBot for more information. We will be sending a recording of this webinar to you later today, and that will include a link to schedule a individualized, personalized demo of the product and our services, so you can learn more about how we can help you as a university take advantage of EduBot.
Great. All right. Thanks for your time, everybody. We appreciate it.
Thank you.